A relativistic runaway electron avalanche is an avalanche growth of a population of relativistic electrons driven through a material by an electric field. RE has been hypothesized to be related to lightning initiation, terrestrial gamma ray flashes, sprite lightning, and to spark development. RE is unique, as it can occur at electric fields an order of magnitude lower than the dielectric strength of the material. When an electric field is applied to a material, free electrons will drift slowly through the material, as described by the electron mobility. For low-energy electrons, faster drift implies higher friction, so the drift speed tends to stabilize. For electrons with energy above about 100 F, however, higher speeds imply lower friction. An electron with a sufficiently high energy therefore may be accelerated by an electric field to even higher and higher energies, encountering less and less friction. As it accelerates, such an electron is described as a runaway. As runaway electrons gain energy from an electric field, they occasionally collide with atoms in the material, knocking off secondary electrons. If the secondary electrons also have high enough energy to run away, they too accelerate at high energies, produce further secondary electrons, etc. As such, the total number of energetic electrons grows exponentially in an avalanche. The RE mechanism above only describes the growth of the avalanche. An initial energetic electron is needed to start the process. In ambient air, such energetic electrons typically come from cosmic rays, in very strong electric fields, stronger than the maximum frictional force experienced by electrons. Even low-energy electrons can accelerate to relativistic energies, a process dubbed thermal runaway. Thank you for watching. For more educational videos, please subscribe to Wiz Science on YouTube or visit wizscience.com. We'll be right back.
I've made quite a few videos about particle accelerators and why we use the ones that we do. But there is one thing that I haven't mentioned, and it's really pretty cool. And that is just exactly how we accelerate particles. And if you make it to the end, I'll let you know why physicists are at least as cool as surfers. I've talked about how we make electric fields to push electrically charged particles around, and that's right to a degree. In the simplest case, we could take two metal plates and connect them to a battery. That creates an electric field between the plates. That electric field can then push an object that carries an electric charge. But that simplified picture isn't how we really do it. It turns out that the electric field in most high-energy particle accelerators isn't static like that. In fact, the electric field in a particle accelerator is actually oscillating. It starts out at zero, then pushes a charged particle in one direction, then pushes it in the opposite direction. The pattern repeats itself over and over and over again. So why do we do it that way, and what consequences are there for that choice? Well, why we do that is perhaps the easiest thing to explain. It's just hard to make very strong static electric fields without a spark occurring. It can be done, but there's an easier way, and it turns out to be pretty cool. Instead, we shoot radio waves into a volume in our accelerator. We call that volume a cavity, and its exact shape and size are very important. We'll get back to that in a minute. Now, you may recall that radio waves are just oscillating electromagnetic fields. Focusing only on the electric side, we get an electric field that gets bigger, then smaller, and then reverses itself. So that doesn't sound so amazing. What's the cool part? Well, it turns out that there is a very interesting phenomenon called resonance, which we can demonstrate using an ordinary swing. You've done this as a child. You sit on the swing and you move your feet back and forth as you lean at the same time. If you do that, you eventually find yourself swinging in big arcs. What you know from that experience, but maybe never really thought about, is that there's a particular rate at which you have to rock back and forth to get the swing moving a lot. Rock back and forth too quickly or too slowly, and you don't get the full swing experience. The particular frequency at which you have to rock is called the resonant frequency. Little motions at that frequency build up over time. Particle accelerators also have a resonant frequency. If you shoot in radio waves of all frequencies into the accelerator, only a certain frequency will grow. And which frequency is the resonant one depends on the shape of the cavity in your accelerator. Some cavities prefer higher frequencies and some prefer lower ones. To get an idea of how that works, think about what happens when you blow the air out of your lungs. It just sounds like the wind. But blow across the top of a 2-liter soda bottle and you get a characteristic tone. Blow across the top of a smaller soda bottle and you get a higher tone. The soda bottle stands in for the accelerator cavity, and you can see how different sized cavities prefer different tones, which means different frequencies. And that characteristic resonant tone of a cavity allows us to put in a relatively small amount of energy in the form of radio waves, but that energy will get amplified into very strong electric fields because of the effect of the resonant cavity. By the way, the technical name for those resonant cavities is an RF cavity. That's because the cavity selects a particular radio frequency, or RF. What I've told you is true in the simplest and most ideal world, and that would be good enough for most people. But you're not most people, are you? You're the kind of person who would want to watch a video about particle accelerator technology. So I'm going to show you one more cool thing. In the words first uttered in the movie, "This is Spinal Tap," what I've shown you thus far is a 10, but I'm going to show you an 11. Funny movie, by the way. You should watch it. Maybe they'll give us a kickback. Okay, so what is this insight that takes us to 11? It comes down to the fact that a particle bunch doesn't have a single charged particle in it. It could have millions, billions, or even hundreds of billions of particles in it. And these bunches don't consist of all particles in exactly the same space, and they don't pass through the accelerator at exactly the same time. And this is important, they don't all have exactly the same energy and velocity. What would be the consequence if we tried really hard to make the center of the bunch arrive at the time when the electric field is the highest? Well, some particles that had more energy would move a little faster, and they would arrive when the electric field isn't at a maximum. So they wouldn't get pushed quite as much as those particles that arrived a little later. So they'd speed up some, but not the maximum amount. On the other hand, the particles that were moving a little slower would arrive when the electric field was bigger. So these particles would get pushed harder and they'd catch up with the faster ones. So far, so good. The problem arises when we talk about the really slow particles, the ones that arrive after the electric field is a maximum. Those slow-moving particles encounter a weaker electric field and get pushed less, so that they can never catch up with their faster guys. And the consequence is that they fall farther and farther behind and the bunch blows up. However, if we arrange the timing so the middle part of the bunch isn't at the maximum of the electric field, we can use the exact same phenomenon to make stable bunches. The faster particles encounter the weakest field and get a small push. The slowest particles encounter the strongest field and get the biggest push, and voila, stable bunches. So that's your 11. It's a counterintuitive part of accelerator design, but just like surfers have to find the sweet spot on a wave, so do particles in real particle accelerators. So there you have it. Now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta get back to the lab. Surf's up.
This is what the plasma light does when you send in two different fundamental frequency square waves. And they are a little bit different in frequency from one another. It begins to pulsate. So these are beating square waves, slightly detuned from one another, causing a fluctuation or a beating, a pulsing of the plasma. You see the meters. We get a power fluctuation. These are with beating frequencies going into the plasma tube.